Hello all, this is Nina and I welcome you to the 43rd episode of the Audible Weed Walk. Remember I had mentioned about Kabasura Kudineer in my podcast sometime back? This is a Siddha medicine with multiple benefits made out of 15 different plants. Many of them are wild, weedy, uncultivated ones and hence my interest. It is currently much in the news since Ayush Ministry has recommended it as a possible supplement to be taken under medical supervision along with, and not instead of, standard treatment for COVID-19 patients who are asymptomatic, had mild symptoms or are recovering. But irrespective of all that, I thought it will be quite interesting to go through the list of 15 plants. Some are available in our pantry, but some are wild, weedy and uncultivated. Out of them, several grows around us and a handful of them are also edible. So what I have done in my last two podcasts is that I have highlighted one plant each, which are, you know, wild and edible in each of those podcasts. Now looking at the list, I see I have two plants that grows around here. One you know very well is giloy and guduchi. This is not edible. This is clearly medicinal. And it has tremendous health benefit, it seems. There are many articles now to how to make kashayam or kara with giloy and even some recipes of such kara by celebrities. But since it is medicinal and there are plenty of information already there, I'm not covering it in my podcast. But just one thing I would like to mention, that it is, you know, diversity is life. Diversity is what gives resilience. So diversity in food, diversity in supplements and diversity in what is what gives greater strength than suddenly depending on one and treating it as a, you know, superfood or soup, you know, panacea of some sort. So this is my personal opinion. So guduchi is excellent, but also, you know, pay attention to you know, better eating, healthier living. So that would be to go along with, that would be nice. So the only other one which grows around here and are also edible is pippali or tippali. It is grown here and it also grows as wild. It comes from Piperaceae family. The scientific name is Piper longum. And this particular family, Piperaceae, has created history, influenced politics, faiths of millions. So I thought, why not take a journey with Piperaceae? Well, the word Piperaceae, from which the word pepper is derived from, actually comes from a Sanskrit word pippali, which refers to piper longum or long paper. From India, pippali had traveled via Arab traders to Africa, where in some parts it is still grown and used in cooking. From there, it had reached Europe. Greeks knew about it way back, like, you know, in 6th or 5th century BCE, and used it more as a medicine than a spice. However, Romans did use it as a spice. It is centuries later that it was replaced by first Piper cubeba or kebab chini, and then by Piper nigrum or black pepper, or we call it peppercorn now. Why exactly this happened, I'm not very sure. Maybe you know, peppercorn is easier to grow, more, you know, preferred taste, you know, less acrid or something. Paper continued in whichever way as one of the high-priced imports for the Romans and via them the rest of Europe. It ultimately led to the age of discovery. You know, Italian explorer Christopher Columbus, who set out to discover a new route for India but ended up in Americas, actually he ended up in Bahamas, still thought he had reached India. Hence he called the Native Americans Indians, and for reason quite unknown he called chili as chili pepper. a name which is still quite widely used, especially in the USA. I remember it was very confusing for me initially, the term chili pepper referring to chilies. For me, chili and pepper are two different entities altogether. And they are. Chili is from Solanaceae family. Same families as tomatoes, eggplants, manthakali, turkey berries. The genus, however, is capsicum. It has no link whatsoever to Peperaceae, Pippali or Tippali. The story about pepper family is a fascinating one. It has literally shaped history, influenced world politics, and therefore, in a way, our lives. Now let's get to our Pippali. While Piper nigrum or peppercorn grew in Malabar coast, Piper longum or Pippali, also known as Indian Tippali or Thippali, originated in Bengal. Now when I say Bengal, it is likely refers to the present day Odisha, West Bengal, parts of Assam, Bangladesh, and probably even beyond. By the 16th century, it was growing widely in the Malabar coast and in other areas of the Deccan Plateau as well. Before the 1500s, when chilies, like the hot chili peppers, actually came to India via the Portuguese, Pippali was widely used in cooking. A 17th century French gem merchant and a traveler, Jean-Baptiste Tavernier, wrote that a handful of pippali being used in making pilaus in his accounts. It is still used in some cooking in Northern Africa, Morocco, Ethiopia, Malaysia and other Southeast Asian cuisine. Further east, Malaysia, Thailand, Bangladesh has yet another pepper. It looks like long pepper. This is Piper chava or Piper retrofractum. The fruit looks very similar to Indian pippali, but I find it a little more colorful. Now, I have to really check that if that is the case. But whatever picture I have seen, and I have never seen this plant myself, it looks that the fruits are more colorful. It is called Bengal tippali or Javan pepper. It's called Shavika in Sanskrit, Choi in Bengali, and Chavya in Tamil. There are both long pepper, which is Piper longum, and Piper chava in further east is referred to as long pepper. So long pepper is supposed to have less heat than peppercorn and more spicy, which means less hot but more flavorful with the undertone of cinnamon, nutmeg like aroma. In West Bengal, Piper longum is used for medicinal purposes. In my experience, it is not used in cooking. But Piper chava, the plant, it used to be used apparently from, you know, some articles that I have read, but it has completely disappeared in the plant and its use. Whereas in Bangladesh, Piper chava or chui is still quite widely used and preferred in certain dishes. So who knows, when centuries back, the gem merchant Jean-Baptiste commented that he actually saw long pepper being used, whether it was Piper longum or Piper chava. And it doesn't matter. I will share with you a recipe right now and tell you a story. This recipe is totally South Indian. Here, tippali or Piper longum is used. The fruit of the plant is called Arisi tippali. Arisi means rice, referring to the shape of the fruit. The other part that is also used is dried roots or kanda tippali. This recipe calls for both peppercorn and tippali. So be prepared. Here it comes. First, dry roast these ingredients. Long pepper roots, kanda tippali, 3 to 5 small pieces. Long pepper fruits, which is Arisathippally, 1 teaspoon. Pepper corn, black pepper, which is half a teaspoon. Cumin seed, 1 teaspoon. Tur dal, 1 tablespoon. Dry roast it first and then grind it along 4 to 6 garlic cloves and set it aside. Then take 1 tablespoon of ghee or any oil. Put mustard seeds and curry leaves for tempering. When the mustard seed splutters, add the ground spice. Cook stirring continuously to avoid burning. Add 2 to 3 chopped tomatoes, 1 cup of tamarind water and 1 cup water. Let the tomatoes get cooked and add more water if necessary to get it to so that it's cooked. And switch off and add some chopped cilantro on top. You have it. Now tell me, which is more popular preparation in the West that is inspired by this recipe? Though I must warn that the current morph, the Western version is quite unrecognizable from this original one. Do you need a clue? Well, here it is. I give you a quote. Memories are like mulligatawny soup in a cheap restaurant. It is best not to stir them. Yep, it is a quote from P.G. Woodhouse. And yes, it is the origin of the mulligatawny soup. Mulligatawny is a combination of Tamil word milagu, pepper, and thanni, water. It is similar to rasam from South Indian cuisine, like the one I just gave you the recipe for. However, by the time rasam turned into mulligatawny, piper nigrum or peppercorn had replaced the thippali totally in that recipe. How did it even start? Well, the story goes, it was considered one of the most popular Anglo-Indian dishes that was invented in Madras. The British are supposed to have asked their cooks to prepare a soup as a starter. The meal is a course starter or appetizer, etc. This kind of coursed meal is an alien concept for most Indian cuisine, where all items are presented at the same time. The cooks presented with this challenge thought rasam could be morphed into a soup very easily. So it was a popular Ayurvedic potion at that time, prescribed for fever, dyspepsia and even cholera. But rasam is eaten with rice. So the cooks added a bit of rice and vegetable in the soup and also meat. Since British were known to be voracious meat eater, much more than even Mughals. So thus emerged a mulligatawny soup, which became very popular in India among the colonizers. But also when the officers returned to England, very hot mulligatawny soup became a staple in Anglo-Indian dinner party and ball. I am now quoting a recipe from Lizzie Collingham's book, Curry, A Tale of Cooks and Conqueror. Cut a chicken to 12 to 16 pieces and boil it with 2 cups of water. Take 5 to 6 cloves of black pepper, 5 ounces each of turmeric, fresh ginger, 5 or 6 slices of garlic, and a dessert spoon of raw coriander with 1 red chili and grind them all together to make a fine paste. Mix the ground paste with the chicken broth and let it boil. After boiling, strain the gravy through a piece of muslin. Warm a heaped teaspoon of ghee in a stew pan and fry a sliced onion. Put the meat and the gravy together. Stir in and allow the curry to boil. Put no acid in the curry. Serve it with a sour lime cut in slices in a separate plate. So there you go. There are many versions of this recipe of mulligatawny. The current and the most popular version includes a thick soup that including rice or rice and lentil both, and one or more types of meat and apple somehow apple has become, apple, celery, these have become quite integral part of the current version of Milagatoni that is popular in the West. My friend Nancy had written a book of soups of different seasons as a fundraiser for a church in Moscow when she was posted there. In many of my moves between continents, I have no clue where that book is, safely tucked, I'm sure, somewhere. But if I get that ever in my hand, I'll give you the recipe. Well, but what are the benefits of the Piper Longum or Piper Chava for the matter? Why is it the mix of, present in the mix of Kabasura Kurineer? What are the other pipers? Hold on those thoughts. I will get back to you next time. Until then, stay well and stay safe. I'll see you next time.